Hello, so welcome to a session on In Conversation with Josephites. So we're going to have a very, very meaningful session today. So we have two rock stars with us today. One side we have Bhuvanya Vijay, on the other side we have Utsav Thakliyal, both are Josephites. Bhuvanya, let me introduce Bhuvanya. Bhuvanya is an All India ISC topper. She got 99% in class 12, top All India rank 1. Post that, she wrote this test called Common Law Aptitude Test, where she got All India rank 14 and got into NLS Bangalore. There also she got university rank 1, got 14 gold medals, passed out from there. So today she specializes in environment law. So we're going to talk to her as to why Bhuvanya, despite the fact she's from BCM, has chosen law as a career. What do lawyers do, new age lawyers do? How unconventional law as a career is, as a matter of fact. So, right, her career goals, aspirations, so on and so forth, right? On the other side, we have another rock star with us, Utsav Thakliyal. I still remember training Utsav for his interviews for IIM Indore IPM program. Now, Utsav was a PCB student. He took biology, he was interested in medicine. And then he figured out this course called IPM offered by IIM Indore. So left medicine, went there, topped, as a matter of fact, got gold medal there in IIM Indore as well. And placed in a company called Ernst & Young, where he's an associate consultant. So we're going to talk to him as well. What exactly is the curriculum here in IIM Indore? What happens there? What life at IIM? How to get into, how to prepare, so on and so forth. So let's have a meaningful interaction. Let us welcome them. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for a very warm and appreciative introduction. Means a lot. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So that's great. Okay. So, we'll would want to have a little informal discussion, right, as well. As a matter of fact, you know, since I've been training and, you know, counseling people since so many years, and when I counsel people, you know, people do have, you know, somebody who takes science, as a matter of fact, and the first thing which comes to their mind is either engineering or medicine. So probably I think this conversation with both of you, you know, since you have taken unconventional routes, right, topping ISC, that too with 99%, and still going for something unconventional, right? Though law is not unconventional these days, but in those times, you know, still not many people were going. So we would want to talk about as to what motivated you to go for law. Same question to Utsav as well. You know, I remember Utsav, you wanted to go for medicine. That is also there at the back of your mind. And even then you got into something like IIM. So we would want both of you to talk about these things. What motivated you to, pick up these careers? Life at a law school, life at an IIM. So how to get into, what does lawyers do specifically, more specifically? You know, first and the foremost thing when we talk about law, someone like Sunny Deol comes to our mind and he's shouting at the top of his voice, Tariq pe Tariq, Tariq pe Tariq, right? I would give it to you, Bhuvanya. So, right. And so let Bhuvanya speak for about 20, 25 minutes, half an hour. Right. And then we'll come to Utsav. Right. So let the senior most start first. Right. Yeah. So yes. Over to you, Bhuvanya.
Okay. Welcome, everybody. I'm happy to see a very handsome turnout. I think we have some 77 participants as of now. And I'm assuming most of you are from my favorite institution on the planet, St. Joseph's Academy, Dehradun. And that makes this interaction all the more delightful for me. I assure you, this would not be a soliloquy or a one-sided lecture. I think overall, I'd like to spend around 40 minutes with you, in which just the first 15 to 20 minutes before Utsav takes over would be running over a brief presentation. And I also have an exercise wherein I'd like to hear from you guys. And I think that can happen through your Zoom chat or Telegram chat. I would prefer if you don't pop up and show your faces and talk through Zoom. I think it'll be better to regulate if you can sort of chat on Telegram or Zoom. And I promise to not be boring or annoying, but would, I think, perhaps agitate all of you enough to burden me with loads of pertinent questions in the remaining, the latter 20 minutes of our time together. So I'll just go on the screen share mode so that I could, you could focus on the slides while I talk. Okay, I hope the screen is visible to all of you. Mr. Manoj, can you see the screen? Okay, I think I've got confirmation from most of you, so I'll continue.
Yeah, your screen is visible. Yeah.
Okay, great, great. So now I'm told that most of you here have already decided what you'll study at university or college level. And for those who haven't, as Sir said, engineering or medicine seem to be both ubiquitous and reliable choices. Of course, there would be some exceptional brains who will pursue a career in management, and were you to follow Utsav's counsel, which will shortly follow, I think you'll maximize your chances of success. But all said and done, and on a lighter note, I'm truly confident that only the greatest minds in this group will end up studying the law. And in this chat, it would be my endeavor to demystify this esoteric and very perplexing area of study called the law. And I'll undertake this by focusing on what are the reasons for studying law, and then keep branching out from those reasons. So I look at the personal qualities that people who study law tend to develop, and it's my opinion that all of us have reason to want to be somebody who has these qualities. So cognitively, that would mean good judgment and super brain training. Linguistically, that would mean learning the skill of rhetoric. Personality-wise, it would mean being humble. Socially, it would mean being hopeful and being politically aware. And finally, professionally, it would mean legal training. This is the degree that you get at the end of the 5 years integrated course. Studying the law, I'd say, is a very good, easy, sure shot, and definitive way of acquiring these qualities. But I definitely wouldn't say that it's the only way, or that you cannot develop these qualities if you pursue some other subject. So I don't wish to persuade you to change your career choices, but I hope that I can at least succeed in making you consider taking up the law. So we'll start off with good judgment, that's discernment. And I want you to read this quote on the screen. It says, "The best lack all conviction, while the worst are full of passionate intensity." And this is by William Butler Yeats in The Second Coming. What does this mean? Someone endowed with good judgment avoids these polar extremes. You know, they can chart a middle course between lacking all conviction and also being full of passionate intensity. If you're full of passionate intensity, you lack good judgment because you have rushed to a judgment. You see only one side of a case. You perhaps demonize those who oppose you or even remotely challenge you. You call them morons or mad instead of seeking to understand what might lead someone to adopt a different position from you. And for an example, we see this very often in current clashes surrounding the environment, where both sides regularly label each other as either liars or as scientific illiterates. Studying the law, however, it keeps you clear from such pitfalls. Why? Because it is an integral part of a law student's training to learn to see what can be said on both sides of a question or an issue. You're taught to think like a lawyer. You're given problematic fact situations right from day one at law school, and perhaps even beginning now when you're coaching for class. And in these fact situations, the law is unclear, but you are encouraged to develop and eventually master the ability to notice and then to explain what can be said on both sides of the issue. And that truly opens up your mind. I'll also come to the flip side of Yeats' quote when he says, if you lack all conviction, now then too, you lack good judgment, or you lack the sense of discernment, because in that case, you're refusing to judge at all. You're refusing to reach a conclusion as to what's good or bad, right or wrong, desirable or undesirable. And this is a very common tendency, particularly among young adults these days. They often confuse the refusal to judge as being tolerant, as being cool, as being open-minded, and they disdain as judgmental people who end up taking the stand. So most of you perhaps by now believe that the truth is a relative concept, you know, that there is no single or absolute truth. And this drowns you in the multiplicity of perspectives. It makes you a very poor decision maker. It perhaps also will end up making you a lousy lawyer. To avoid this, the study of the law, the first thing that it teaches you is just because you can see a mountain from different angles and different sides, and hence you can visually perceive different shapes, doesn't mean that the mountain does not have a unique objective shape. It's just that you are oblivious to it. Hence, while you must be aware of all possible perspectives and all possible arguments on both the sides of an issue, at the end of the day, the study of the law teaches you to decide who has the better case. So you can respect people and their multifarious opinions, but the law trains you to see which side of an argument is better, either by spotting a logical flaw or a fallacy in one side's argument, or by accurately weighing the two sides' arguments against each other and see who comes out stronger. And this is how the law gives you the first gift that I talked about, that's the gift of discernment, which will come in handy for life. Of course, the law also gives you another cognitive skill, which is a very unique kind of brain training. And this helps you think rather than just rote learn and regurgitate information. You reason your way to a sensible conclusion. And this is where, in order to show how the law perhaps gives you a good amount of brain training, is I'll come to a brief exercise. And I wish to hear from some of you. So we'll do it via Telegram or via the Zoom chat. And this is also perhaps very similar to what you have done in the legal reasoning segment of class. So please read these two situations with me on the screen. The first situation is when you have a notorious terrorist T who kidnaps D's wife and two children and threatens to kill them unless D delivers a package containing a bomb to V, the ambassador at an embassy to which D has access. D delivers the package, and when V opens the package, it explodes, and unfortunately, V dies. Okay, so the question here is, has this chap D, who has delivered the package to the ambassador, committed murder? And the definition by which you are to figure if indeed murder has been committed is on the left-hand side of the slide. It says someone commits murder if his or her actions cause another to die, and he or she has performed those actions intending to kill someone or to cause someone to suffer serious bodily harm, and he or she had no lawful justification or excuse for acting as he or she did. So I hope you have read at least the first situation and the definition of murder on the left-hand side. My first question to you is, what are the elements of murder as provided by this definition on the left? And there's a subpart to that question. Whatever these elements are, do we need all of them to be satisfied to prove that D has committed murder, or is it an either-or sort of a condition? So can I please start hearing from you? I have opened the Telegram link and I'll be waiting. Please let me know if any of you want me to repeat the question. I'm willing to do that too. Okay, so I hear from Mr. Kanaksha Kataria, who says intention to murder plus the physical act of murder are the components of murder. Okay. Falguni tells me action, intention, and lack of justification. Great. Manya wants me to repeat. So Manya, there's a fact situation on the screen. I'll put it up for you again. And I want you to read situation number one and then read the definition on the side and tell me what are the three elements of murder in this definition. I'm going to wait for another 30 seconds. A couple of people are typing, and then I think we'll proceed with our discussion. If typing is taking time, please let me know. I would want some of you to perhaps speak on the Zoom window. Okay, we have Ayushi, who says cause another to die, intending to murder, and no lawful justification. Intention to kill or cause harm to someone without any justification or excuse. So I think I have gotten enough answers for the first half of the question, which is you are correct. The elements of murder are three in this definition. The first is that these actions cause we to die. This is the first element, cause another to die. The second is D has acted with an intent. So the second element is intention, and that intent is to kill, or it is an intent to cause serious bodily harm or injury. And the third element is that D, while having committed this action and this intention, had no lawful justification or excuse. So I think a bunch of you have answered this bang on correct. So I'll move on to my second question. Tell me, has D committed murder in the first situation now? And for those of you who are typing, please perhaps just pop up, show me your face and talk to me on Zoom, because I believe there are very little students who are actively typing. I'll repeat my second question. The second question is, given this definition, has D committed murder in situation one? Okay, everyone is saying no, but I also want you to back your answers. I mean, give me some reason, give me a speaking order. Justify why you're saying no. And by the way, no might be, and me might be the incorrect answer here. Ryan Subha says, I don't believe so. As D had a reasonable excuse, he was forced to do so. Okay. Adi Jain says, there was no intent. Also, there is justification. I want to hear from Adi Jain. Adi Jain, in situation one, what is the justification? Okay. Prerna Garg says he was forced to do so. So coercion is actually not mentioned in the fact situation at all. Vabhav Thapliyal says yes, because he intends to kill Wee, though not by himself. Again, there are a lot of people who are saying forced to do so. Mr. Mittal, can the students speak to me? I think some of them mentioned that they have been permanently muted. So is it possible for them to speak to me via the Zoom chat?
Let me try.
Okay, thank you. Okay, any other answers? Can we go point-wise? So I'm going to ask a point-wise question and I want you to say yes or no. Number one, has D caused V to die? Has D's actions caused V to die? The first element, has that been satisfied? Please say yes or no, quickly. Okay, I get a lot of yeses, that's correct. Element number two, has D acted with an intention to kill? Yes or no? Okay, most of you are correct here. And this is where we say that D has not committed murder because we don't even need to reach to the third element. The second element here is not satisfied. Some of you might feel that the package contained a bomb and hence it would be clear that D could foresee that if he were to deliver this package, we would die because the bomb would explode and that he intended to kill D. But when you start thinking carefully and you perhaps present yourself with a hypothetical and you're thinking like a lawyer here. Ask yourself a question. If you foresee that appearing for a 2-hour exam will result in you getting tired, does that mean that you intend to get tired when you appear for that exam? Doesn't that sound implausible? It does, because intending something to happen is very different from foreseeing that something will happen, as these two different words would not have existed in the English dictionary. If you intend something to happen, you try to make that very thing happen. And over here in the first situation, when D delivers the package, he's not trying to kill Wee. What he's trying to do is deliver the package. That's where his intention ends. So this is some sort of, you know, this is a real life example of how some careful lawyer-like thinking leads you to conclude that D has not committed murder. Now, for my third question, I would like you to go through the second fact situation, which I'll share on the screen shortly. Okay, so the second situation, you have T, a notorious terrorist, the same guy, who is kidnapping D's wife and two children and threatening to kill them unless D kills D's best friend, Wee, who is an important politician, and D goes and ends up killing Wee. So again, now I want you to answer my third question. Has D committed murder in this case? For the benefit of all of you, I'll read out the fact situation again. It's the second situation on the right-hand side. D has kidnapped D's wife and two children, threatens to kill D unless D kills this certain person, Wee, who is an important politician, and D ends up killing that politician. So please tell me, has D committed murder? Again, we like to go element-wise. First, tell me, first element, have these actions caused Wee to die? Yes or no? Okay, great. I get the right answer from almost all of you saying yes. Second question is, has D acted with an intention to kill here? Was he trying to kill Wee when he killed Wee? Does the intention exist here? Okay, I'm quite glad to see that most of you have not got confused on the second element. You're indeed correct. Yes, there was an intention to kill when D killed Wee here. Now coming to the moot question, that is the third element, is that satisfied? Please tell me, is this a case of lawful justification
Yes.
or is this a case of excuse? Take a wild guess. Just type in your answer. Type LJ for lawful justification and type E for excuse. Okay, I got an answer from Reed Bubbles who says there's no justification for killing that politician just because he was related to that person. I'm unable to make sense of this. Reed, would you mind clarifying, please? Mania tells me it's lawful justification. Ayushi Saini says there is no justification. Usha Sharma says justification. I'm just wondering, are all of you following the, you know, the herd mentality on the Zoom chat? Because no one has bothered saying it's an excuse. Do you think it's an excuse? Okay, Surbhi Dikshit is the first person to say it's an excuse. Meanwhile, on the Telegram, I hear, I think it's a case of lawful justification as D acted under duress. No, please don't bring in alien concepts here. The fact situation doesn't mention anything. The definition doesn't say coercion or duress or anything, so don't mention that right now at this stage. Manas Rawat also says excuse, no lawful justification. Okay, so I think I've taken enough answers. I'll try to give you some clarity now. What's the difference between the two? When we say that some person's actions are justified, we seem to be saying that that person did the right thing in those circumstances. And when they're justified under the law, then that's a lawful justification. Such as a public servant discharging his duty in good faith, that's a lawful justification. But when we say that a certain person's actions are excused, it's something different altogether. Doing the right thing doesn't need an excuse. It's only when you do the wrong thing that you might seek to be excused for what you did on the basis that your conduct, while very wrong and regrettable, was so understandable that it could be wrong to blame you for acting as you did. So that's the difference between justification and excuse. In this case, no, D does not have any lawful justification. He did not do the right thing in killing somebody with no cause and with no law backing him. So he did the wrong thing in killing me, but it was so understandable that he found it difficult, if not impossible, to stand up to the kidnapper's threat and allow the kidnapper to kill his wife and children, that it is understandable why we can't blame him for his actions, and hence he is excused. You know, this exists as an excuse for him, and he cannot be blamed for killing me. So that is the reason why D, in the second situation too, has not committed a murder, because the third element is not satisfied. Am I clear to everybody? Is the distinction very clear? Please say yes or no on the group chat or the Zoom chat. Yes. So you now you understand how, you know, I hope this little exercise has convinced most of you about how interesting and enlightening and cerebral the study of the law is and how it truly opens up your brain. So that's the kind of brain training that I was talking about. I will move on further on my slide. I'll just share the presentation with you again. Okay, so linguistically too, okay, so we're done with the first two parts. Now we come to the third element, which is linguistically. The law trains you in the art of rhetoric. It sharpens your tongue and pen. Rhetoric is nothing but persuading somebody with good reason, with fallacy-proof arguments, to adopt a particular point of view by speaking and writing effectively. So you're no longer lifeless and dull in the way you are interacting and writing. There's, of course, this one iron rule of lawyering, that's to express yourself clearly or to die. While lawyers do end up using confusion as a courtroom tactic, and there are some vaguely worded legislative pieces too, the idea is to make yourself understood and to have very crisp and effective arguments. And under any circumstances, it's difficult to, you know, make something brief, as it is brought out by this quote by Blaise Pascal. Moving on shortly, I think rhetoric is pretty clear to all of you. Personality-wise, the law makes you humble. It teaches you that the best laid plans of mice and men often go astray, and what's perhaps good on paper can go hopelessly counterproductive in execution. So in litigation too, you'll perhaps lose some cases. In a corporate firm, you'll be yelled at by bosses. As an academic, your students and publishers won't perhaps always be happy with you or pleased with you in the scrutiny of your tests, laws, and judgments. Some of you will acquaint yourselves with the failings of humanity. So, you know, lawyers have always been very aware of an inherent tendency in humans to self-deception, to rationalizing our behavior, so that we can identify acting in our self-interest with doing the right thing, even when it's actually, in fact, absolutely wrong thing to do. But the law has rules to guard against it, which is what keeps you humble. For example, if I am to give 10,000 rupees to a fiduciary to invest on my behalf, they must act carefully in investing my money. But the law also imposes an additional duty on them, which is that they cannot benefit from the way that they invest or spend my money. So they can't, for example, invest my money in a company that the fiduciary owns, even if they're convinced that it's absolutely the best thing to do. So, you know, this is how the law prevents them from making a profit for themselves in acting as a fiduciary. And that's how, you know, in several examples, you can see how the law keeps your humility intact. The fourth aspect of studying the law is how, from a societal perspective, it, of course, encourages a sense of altruistic hope. The very existence of the law is based on a hopeful concept that if you work together, if you help each other, we all can be far better off than we would be if we simply did what was in our self-interest at any given point in time. So the cumulative public collective good, if we work towards it, ends up trumping your self-interest. And this, in order to explain this, I'll introduce you to another very interesting concept. It's called the prisoner's dilemma. And I want you to see this slightly confusing, but I'm sure all of you will get it. Matrix on the right side. Now, what does it say? It says, two prisoners are arrested for committing a bank robbery, and they have very weak evidence against them. They can't also communicate with each other. If both of them stay silent, so please look at this column, the one I'm highlighting, 0, 0. If both of them stay silent, they'll walk free. Both of them just get 0 years. To give each of the prisoners an incentive to inform on the other, the prosecutor tells them that if one confesses and the other stays silent, then the one confessing will get 5 years in jail, and the one staying silent will get 15 years in jail. And that is what the matrix here too shows. If prisoner one stays silent while prisoner two confesses, one gets 15 years and two gets 5 years in prison. But if they both confess, they both end up getting only 10 years each in jail. So now you see what has happened. If each does what is in their self-interest, each would confess. He'll think, well, if I confess, the worst that can happen is that I do 10 years in jail, I might end up only serving 5 if the other chap doesn't confess. So that's a better option than not confessing, which would result in that person having a chance of serving 15 years in jail. And the other one would think the same way. So both end up confessing and both end up getting 10 years. Now, if each had, imagine a scenario, refused to act in self-interest, but they had indeed chosen to act in a way that looks out for the fellow prisoner, please notice how neither of them would have confessed. Because sitting alone in his cell and thinking about the prosecutor's offer, prisoner one would have realized that staying silent would be the absolute best thing that he can do for prisoner two. Why? Because if one stays silent and two confesses, two would do only 5 years in jail. And if both stay silent, two wouldn't do any time at all. And two would have thought the same thing about one. So neither of them would have ended up confessing, and both would have been free men. So, you know, this is how it tells you that decisions that are good for individuals can sometimes be terrible for groups. And that is exactly where the law also brings in altruistic hope for the society. It is the lawmaker who determines what those situations are when we mustn't act in self-interest, but do what is best for somebody else. And when we act like this, thanks to the law, two very hopeful things occur. First, we realize that just selfishly pursuing our own interests in a mutually destructive way results in a society where life is nasty, brutish, and short, which is how the famous philosopher Thomas Hobbes described life to be in a lawless society. And second, that people are indeed capable of working together to construct a better society than if they all were to blindly pursue their immediate self-interest. So that's how the law instills in you a sense of altruistic hope. So now I will move on, and we will see what the second thing from a societal perspective the law does. It's that it trains you in politics. It makes you a very relevant, informed citizen. It helps you to form your own views as to what sort of a society we should live in. It puts you in a good position to provide an informed contribution to the future shaping of your society. You can look at the law as a sort of conversation among lawmakers who determine how every aspect of your life can be bettered via regulation. In short, the study of the law makes you politically aware and also politically prudent, since studying the law gives you a practical sense of what works and what doesn't work in real life. And this is particularly true for the 5-year integrated BALLB honors degree program. since it exposes you to a range of other subjects too, history, economics, political science, sociology, international relations, and many more, which end up widening your horizon. And finally, speaking from a professional point of view, the study of the law renders you the sort of legal training which opens up innumerable prospects after the law is done. As you see on the slide, you can litigate or practice in court. You can work in corporate firms. You can be an academic, teaching, writing, researching, engaged in policy making. You can join the public services. You can enter politics. You can be a superb public speaker and all in all have a far more profound chance at being an intellectual. As examples, we have around 55%, 25 out of 45 US presidents who've been lawyers. That includes Obama and Bill Clinton. Then people write from the father of our nation, Gandhi, to our constitution's chief architect, B.R. Ambedkar, to the country's first prime minister, Jawaharlal Nehru, to several current apolitical figures, Jaitley, Sushma Swaraj, those who have unfortunately lost, Kapil Sibal, Harish Salve, Mukul Rohatgi, all of these people, their names are on the screen. People who influence the public discourse and who have one thing in common is that they're all lawyers. So now, having explored all of these reasons for studying the law, I believe I have the last 3-4 minutes left. The most important moot question is the law really for me? Just because Bhuvanya has given me 5 brackets of reasons to study the law, does that mean I should blindly take up the study of the law? So that question can be best answered when you answer these questions. Studying the law is interesting. It is important. It's educational. But that by itself is not why you must get a law degree. As a subject for study, it is, of course, unparalleled, because it's practically impossible to find an area which is so fascinating, so significant, so relevant, and so transformative as the law. And it's one area of study which is neatly tying up every aspect of the society. You know, the thread of law is weaving together the fabric of society. But it is also not for everyone. So I want you to answer some of these questions for yourself, not for me. And this will perhaps give you a realistic picture of the day-to-day grind of law school. I'll read out some of them to you. The first question is, how comfortable are you with the idea of spending the majority of each day in silence reading difficult, dense material? And mind me, that's going to be a good part of your life as a lawyer, whether in law school or beyond. Do you or could you have the stamina to read dry, complicated material for at least 4 to 6 hours a day, every day of your life? Are you self-reliant or do you depend on others for constant encouragement, evaluation, or affirmation? Are you disciplined enough to get up and attend classes every day? I don't know what's the scene with other law schools, but at least from my law school, National Law School, Bangalore, you have a very jam-packed trimester system. You have 4 courses in 3 months, and attendance is a major requirement. So for those of you who, you know, succumb to certain mental pressures or maybe some disease, and are not able to maintain that level of discipline and devotion to get up and attend classes each day, that by itself becomes a major reason for slacking off. Have you been able to will yourself through difficult periods in your life? I'll move to some questions on the right-hand side. Do you like to write critically and analytically? When you've given your very best effort, will you be able to sleep at night knowing that you have done the best you could, or are you more likely to beat yourself up wondering if there was more that you could have done? Are you able to move on quickly? You know, you can just get over a defeat or get over a walking down moment. Are you ready to make the law your life for the next 5 years at least? That's assuming the time that you spend in law school. And is it possible for you to sometimes sacrifice your hobbies, your other interests, your social life for a more serious academic dedication? So, you know, I would recommend that you guys ask yourself these questions. I'd be sharing these slides with you after this session is over. You don't have to answer yes to all of those questions. Even saying yes to 60 to 70% means you'll work things out just fine with the law. But the idea is that on the basis of a realistic self-assessment, you should figure how much of this is in sync with what drives you. You know, very little of the law is about Stoop or Boston Legal. And of course, to quote Mr. Manoj's example also, very little of the law is also about Tariq Pe Tariq, what Sunny Deol did. Things do move fast these days, but yes, it does end up getting frustrating too. So if you've had too many OOs during this evaluation, you should take that as a warning. For example, if you don't like to read, I think you'll be making a big mistake applying to law school. And with this, I'll move on to my final slide, which also I'll make available to you after this session. I would recommend that each one of you carefully go through this material before you start your journey at law school. of course, one of this, most of these are examples from American law school, but we are all very adept at, you know, sort of customizing it to our experience in India. The first is a Coursera course by a Yale University professor, which I think people who have cleared class and are about to set foot into law school can really benefit from. And with this, I'd like to wrap up my 20 minutes. I think, Mr. Manish, you can take over and we can hand it over to Utsav, and then we can take some questions at the end of the session.
Yeah. So thanks, Bhuvanya. That was really insightful. And I'm sure that really helps. That really helps. Yeah.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Thank you so much. Okay. So Utsav, over to you.
Sure, sir.
Right? Yeah.
So hi, everyone. A little bit of background about me. I joined the 5-year MBA program at IIM Indore. I'm not sure how many of you know about this program. It's called the IPM program. And it started in 2011. So it's almost 9 years old now. The IPM program is a novel program because it is one of the only programs which are offered at an IIM and which offer the chance to join a B school right after class 12. Instead of the usual route of joining a B school after completing an undergraduation from some other college and then clearing CAT exam to join a B school. But the larger picture that I want to build before I talk about my program or talk about IPM and other such programs is, what is management? Is management for you? And how you should, you know, keep this process in mind, you know, at your stage in class 11 or class 12. So first of all, I was a PCMB student, and a large part of why I was a PCMB student is because when we are in class 11 or class 12, go into science, and everybody else, are ye to commerce wala hai. And I think that's one of the most unfortunate realities, of our school system right now, that we evaluate your own credentials or your own aptitude just on the basis of the subjects you like to study or the subjects you end up studying. Talking very specifically about me, what I had going on in my mind when I was in class 12, I was preparing for the AIPMT exam. And after my class 12, I did clear, a few exams to get some admission offers from some medical colleges. But some of the arguments that were going on inside my head were, if I go for medicine, how many years will I be studying before I become a doctor? What will be my future lifestyle be like? Will I have to study 10 years to finish enough qualifications to, start a good practice? Some other thoughts that were going on inside my head were, what sort of courses will I be taking? How hectic will it be for me? What will the life of a doctor be like? But I think the most important question all of you should ask yourself when preparing for a career is, what is your skill set? What are you good at? And on the basis of that, you should decide what do you want to do, instead of, looking around and seeing what somebody else is doing and deciding, oh, this is what I want to do. I think the process should be more inside out rather than outside in. Inside out, by that I mean that first you need to look at yourself, your own strengths and weaknesses, look at what do you like to do, look at what you're doing right now, and on the basis of that, decide what you want to do for the rest of your life. So I'll just build a little bit about, what skill sets I thought about when I joined a management career. So first of all, let's talk about what skills are required in management. The first one I'd like to talk about is interpersonal skills. What I mean by that is, do you feel that you are a person who likes to talk to other people, who likes to understand other people, who can work well with other people? Are you a person who can, talk to people and convince them to join, an initiative that you have taken up? Are you a person who can talk to someone and become a good leader? Are you someone who can work very well in teams? So these are the sort of skills that are required, interpersonal skills. And if you are a manager, these are very important skills for you to have. Tomorrow, you may be a CEO of a company, you may be leading a team, you may be launching a new product. And for that, you need to be someone who works well with your team, who talks to people, who motivates people, who is able to work well with superiors and with other people. Some of these skills may generically be applied to other career tracks as well, but very specifically for management, these are the questions that you should ask yourself and which are important for you.
Utsav, can you share your screen?
Yes, sir, I'll be doing that. I have a PPT ready for that. So I'll be coming to that soon. The second sort of skill set I ask myself, and which I encourage you to also ask yourself about, is communication skills. Are you someone who is able to express the thoughts that are there inside your head in a concise and concrete way? As Bhuvania was talking about, communication skills, rhetoric, linguistic skills are an important part of a law student's career too. But even for a manager, you know, you may be someone who has worked very well, you've made the best reports, you've worked very hard. But if you're not able to convey to your boss or to your investors or to your team about what you have done, then that's a very big failure on your part. So therefore, it is important that you have good communication skills and you are someone who is able to articulate their thoughts in a refined and proper way. So communication skills are, you know, a second skill set that you should ask yourself about. And third, the third skill set that I want to talk about is analytical skills. Are you someone who looks at a problem and is able to break that problem down into, you know, small concrete parts so that they can be solved more easily later on? Are you someone when you face a maths question in school or, you know, any other questions or any other life dilemmas, you're able to think about that without panicking, you know, without being confused and able to break that down into small parts and be able to solve that? And that is what I mean by analytical skills. So therefore, the larger point that I'm trying to build over here is, if you feel that you are someone who works well in teams, if you feel you can articulate your thoughts in a precise and refined way, and if you feel that you are someone who's a problem solver, a management career might be for you. So what are management careers? What is management? Now, as many of you know, we live in a society where there are many companies which offer products and services. We live in a society where there are startups launched every year, which, you know, try to solve people's problems. Now, there are many ways to get into companies. There are many functions that you can be doing over there. But as a class 11 and 12 student, one thing I would like to, you know, express to you is that a very good way to understand how businesses work is to do an MBA. An MBA is called a Master of Business Administration. And these are programs that teach you various facets of a business, such as marketing, finance, human resources, and operations and strategy. And these teach you how businesses work, how businesses run, how the economy works, and how you can play a part to, you know, help these businesses run. These MBA careers have really taken off, you know, in the past few decades, because there has been a surge of companies, there has been a surge of jobs. And today, these are some of the most well-paying and well-respected jobs which are there in our economy. So as I, you know, mentioned earlier, MBA programs can be joined in IIMs, which are some of the most prestigious colleges for these. These are known as business schools. And you join them after giving the CAT examination, after doing some other undergraduate course. However, a very good option for you right now is to join the integrated program in management. This is currently offered at IIM Indore and at IIM Rohtak. And I am an alumnus of the IIM Indore program. So that brings me to, you know, the prepared section of my presentation, where I'll be talking about the integrated program in management at IIM Indore that I attended. I'll be covering the structure of the program and the admission procedure. And then I'll also be mentioning a little bit about the fees of the program and, you know, what scholarships are offered. Can everyone see my screen?
Yes, Utsav.
Okay, sure. So we already covered about me. So let's move ahead from here. So the IPM program is offered at IIM Indore. It is a 5-year program. After the first 3 years of the program, you're offered an undergraduate degree of BA Foundations of Management. And after that, you merge with the same batch that comes in after giving the CAT examination. And then you have a 2-year program, which awards you a Master of Business Administration degree. Now, talking about what do you study in this IPM program. So the IPM program has 3 basic pillars. There are 3 broad areas that you will be studying in the first 3 years. The first area is economics. So economics, you know, covers a lot of aspects that you would be covering if you join colleges, for example, in Delhi University. If you join a BA Economics Honours program in Delhi University or other such colleges. So the purpose of studying economics is that economics is, you know, the fundamental basic block of understanding business administration. If you want to understand finance, if you want to understand aspects of marketing, the building block of that is to understand economics. So therefore, what the IPM program does is that for people who want to take up a corporate career ahead, it builds a good foundation in subjects such as microeconomics, macroeconomics, environmental economics, development economics, so that people have a good understanding of how the economy works, how corporations work, how businesses work. And that is the first pillar that is covered in the IPM program. The second pillar is subjects of mathematics and statistics. So the purpose of these subjects is that they build analytical rigor in the students. What I mean when I say they build analytical rigor, they train your brain to think about problems in a certain way. What they train you to do is that when you look at a problem, you're able to break it down into fundamental parts, and that makes it more easier for you to solve. It gives you the ability to work with large numbers. It makes you comfortable working with a lot of data. And that builds you as a very good base for a good corporate career ahead. However, the most salient part of IPM, and this is something that I enjoyed as part of my 5-year course, is the very strong foundation that is built in courses from humanities. By courses from humanities, I mean that students in IPM study subjects like psychology, sociology, political science, international relations, philosophy, and many other such humanities subjects. Now, you may be wondering that I am studying mathematics and statistics. Why am I studying art side subjects suddenly? But the purpose of these is that these subjects are, again, a core building block of subjects like human resources or marketing later on. And the other purpose that these subjects serve is that they build perspective inside you. They train you to view the world in a more different way. They train you to understand people better, to understand the world better. And because of this, you are able to think about a same problem in multiple perspectives. And that makes you a deeper thinker, a better person, a more intellectual person. And this is what builds an edge in IPM students over other students who come in through the CAT examination. Because students who come in through the CAT examinations do not have the same sort of perspectives, do not have the same sort of good foundation that IPM students have, they often lag behind in the subjects that they study in their 2-year MBA program. However, for students who come in through the 5-year program, the initial 3 years build a very good foundation in management disciplines. And because of that, they're not only able to ace the 2 years that they are studying, they also perform better when they are in their working world later on. Moving on to one of the most important reasons why people consider B schools, it is for the future prospects and the future career prospects that they seek from there. So talking about placements, IPM students perform exceptionally well in the industry. As I mentioned, the program is almost 9 years old now. So there is a huge alumni network who have been working in the industry and have been performing well in the industry. And they have received good feedback, because of which there are many companies that come back again and again to recruit IPM students. The IPM placements, job packages, most of these are at par with the other students who come in through the CAT examination. And students currently work in some of the leading firms in profiles such as marketing or finance or sales or consulting or in general management. However, it is not necessary that if you join the IPM program, you only go into the corporate route of working a corporate job at some company. Many people have done, very different things after they have joined the program. So the program has an offer that after the end of the first 3 years, you are able to leave the institute, leave IIM Indore, and you're awarded a BA degree for the first 3 years, and you can opt to not complete the last 2 MBA years of the program. At the same time, there is also an option that students complete the first 3 years of the program, and then they take a little break, and then they go work somewhere, get some work experience. And after that, they come back to the institute and complete the last 2 years of the MBA program. The advantage that this option gives you is that you gain some work experience before you do the 2 MBA years of the program. Not only do students, go for corporate jobs, etc., there are some students who have, after the first 3 years, left the institute and they have gone on to pursue higher education. Some have gone on to pursue PhD programs in India or abroad. Some have left to apply for civil services, etc. Whatever route you choose to take, because the first 3 years build a good foundation in a lot of disciplines, it opens a lot of doors for you. You can go into, you know, higher education about economics. You can go into higher education for statistics. You can go into higher education on subjects like psychology or political science and stuff like that. So the first 3 years, you know, because they build a foundation in a variety of disciplines, they offer you a launch pad to, you know, going into very different directions. Not only this, IPM also provides a good launch pad for entrepreneurs. Today, we will live in an age where there are many startups opening up, people starting their own companies, their own ventures, and doing very well over there. So IIM Indore offers an option that students who are entrepreneurial, who want to start their own startups, start their own companies, start their own business ideas, can do that inside the college itself. They get funding and support through the college, and they can do their business in college or outside college, and they get a lot of support for that. So if you are someone who, you know, thinks of himself as a business leader who wants to start his own business later on in the future, then IPM is the program for you. So let's come to the brass tacks now. Very specifically, how do you join the program? And so the program has a 3-stage process to join the program. The first of all is the application stage. The applications usually open, you know, in the month of March, and the applications do require some data about your academic proficiency. They require some data about what extracurricular activities have you done, and that is the application stage. After the application, there is an exam called the IPM Aptitude Test. I will be covering some more details in the next slide about what is the IPM Aptitude Test and how you should be preparing for it. But the basic logic of the test is to test your logical reasoning, your proficiency in English, and your proficiency in mathematics. For students who clear the IPM Aptitude Test, they're invited for a personal interview round. So the personal interview round includes a written analysis test, which tries to see how you communicate and how you're able to write. And at the same time, there is a personal interview, which is organized with a 3-person panel of IIM Indore professors. Now, talking about the IPM Aptitude Test, what is the test like and how should you be preparing for it? So the test includes, the test is of 160 marks. And I'm sorry, the test is of 100 questions of 400 marks. It is divided into 3 broad sections. The first of all is the quantitative ability section. The quantitative ability section is mathematical ability in a broad sense. It includes questions on logical reasoning. It includes questions, the syllabus of which is mathematics up till a class 10 level. So therefore, students who do not have mathematics in class 11 and 12 can still apply for IPM, and they can still clear IPM because the syllabus for this is mathematics up to class 10 level. However, having said that, just because it is maths of class 10 level does not mean it is easy. It is still, you know, one of the toughest programs which is there in India to crack. You know, almost 20 to 25,000 people apply every year, and only 120 people get selected. So it is one of the most competitive programs to join. So even though the syllabus for the mathematics section is up till class 10 level, it is not easy. What I would like to suggest to students is that mathematics and quantitative ability is not something you learn. What is very important is that you are in an environment where you get to practice regularly and where you can be nurtured and given the best guidance. So therefore, I advise you that even if you want to prepare for other colleges or, you know, things like JEE or other colleges or other programs like CLAT, etc., you can easily manage preparation for other exams and other courses along with the IPM aptitude test. What I would like to advise you is do devote a lot of time and do seek a lot of guidance for the IPM aptitude test very specifically, because this is a program and this is a test that keeps evolving every year, and it is a tough you know, exam to crack. And you do require some structured training and structured practice for it. Aside from the mathematical ability section, there is a verbal ability section. The verbal ability section tests your ability in English, in language, and the syllabus for this is up till the class 12 level, which is regular, which is almost like the sort of syllabus you have for your class 12 board examinations. These all these sections combined have around 100 questions, and the total marks is around 400 marks that you can be scoring. Some general advice about the IPM aptitude test is try to devote at least 1 or 2 hours of practice every day to the IPM aptitude test throughout your year. I would do advise you to, you know, attend some coaching classes or attend preparations so that you're able to practice in a structured way, in a structured training way, which will help you to clear this examination. After the IPM aptitude test, there is a section called, there is a second tier assessment called the VAT and PI assessment. So this includes a written ability test where candidates are asked to, you know, describe their views on a specific topic. This is almost like writing an essay, but what they try to seek is your ability to think on a topic, whether you're able to make structured arguments and present them very well in good grammar and good English. After this, the second step is the personal interview test. So the personal interview tests your academic ability on subjects you have done in class 12. And at the same time, they test your confidence and communication skills. Now, one big, very important thing that I would like to talk about is management as a career is not just for commerce students. It is not necessarily that if you have commerce, you get an edge when you're preparing for IPM or for that matter, any management related subjects or courses. Even if you're a science student or even if you're a commerce student, everyone is equally welcome to apply for IPM and to clear IPM. In fact, from my own experience in my own batch, there were 70% students who had had science in their class 12 examination. Whether you have science or whether you have commerce, this program, you know, fits into everyone's worldview equally, and it does not give any particular advantage to a science student or a commerce student as such. As I described previously, the aptitude test does not cover subjects like physics, chemistry, biology. It does not cover subjects such as economics, accounting, or anything like that. The aptitude tests are exactly as they describe. They are about aptitude. What they want to see is your ability to solve, you know, questions in a logical and, you know, smart way. So therefore, that is why they only test mathematics and English. And whether you're a science student or whether you're a commerce student, you're equally welcome to apply for IPM. Talking about the fee structure of IPM, for resident Indian students, the fees is 4 lakh rupees per annum for the first 3 years. And for the last 2 years, the fees is 16.1 lakhs for both of the years. Now, this may seem intimidating that the fee structure of IPM is very high, but for convey people that there are a lot of financial assistance options which are available for all students. This is something that I want to convey because this is something that I did not know about. And I do not want that people are not able to give the IPM exam or shy away from joining IPM because they are unaware of the fact that there is a lot of financial assistance available. So firstly, the college offers need-based financial assistance. As part of this, they evaluate your family income and your ability to pay for the high fees that IIM Indore charges. And if they feel that you deserve some financial assistance, you can get almost as much as 100% financial assistance, 100% scholarship to join the program. And besides this, there are education loans available. Most private and public banks offer education loans of the full amount to IPM students without any collateral and at very less interest rates. So the last point of why I want to describe about this is that students need to be aware that their financial standing at the present moment should never impact what sort of courses they want to join or what sort of opportunities they seek. I think, you know, you should apply everywhere, try your hand at everything. But most importantly, try to think about the skill set that you have and where you best fit in. So this is the sort of prepared remarks I had. And I would like to hand it back to Manoj sir now.
Okay. So thanks Utsav. Okay, so I think we can quickly take a few questions on the chat box from all the participants, And before you guys, you know, throw questions to both our superstars, so I have one question to both of you. We'll start with Bhuvanya first. You know, I think students would really want to know, what did Bhuvanya did, right, to ensure that she got into National Law School Bangalore and secured such a high rank? I remember, I think your All India rank was 14?
Yes, sir, 14.
Yeah. So, what should be done, more specifically, if you're there in class 11th and 12th, and you have to also manage your class 11th and 12th academics, and you have to score high there as well. So, how do you go about it?
Yeah, that's a pertinent question. I was hanging on to, you know, somebody asking me this question in the question and answer session. I'm glad you led with that, sir. So, I think first and foremost, it's just important to enjoy whatever is scheduled for you to do, whether that is your PCM studies in school, or whether that is learning something interesting in terms of legal knowledge, or it is reading the newspaper to ace the general knowledge section of the class. Whatever it is that you're undertaking, please try to give in your 100% and try to create your mental setup in a way that you develop interest in it, because there is absolutely no area of study, there is no career, there is no discipline which is not rewarding, A, and B, in which you cannot over time develop interest in. Of course, you have a natural flair, you have a natural skill set, as Uttam also mentioned, which will make you better in some things, in certain areas and professions and subjects. But the way we are, you know, the way we exist as human beings, for you to put in a basic amount of effort, and the effort also not in terms of studying, but also to convince your brain that this is interesting, I'm getting to learn something new, it will end up interesting, it will feed your curiosity, and you will, it'll be easier for you to, you know, sort of go through that phase. So that's the first most important thing. As far as my personal experience is concerned, I joined the LST Career Launcher crash course after my 12th boards had ended. And of course, the idea of pursuing the law was abundantly clear in my head, I think, class 12th onwards. I was certain of not pursuing engineering. Medicine I couldn't do. I was not a biology student, 11th and 12th. And the reason why I chose the law was, A, it offered a sure shot professional qualification when you are not pursuing medicine or engineering. And I don't mean to belittle or demean the experiences of those students who end up pursuing a 3-year graduation course, but vis-a-vis those 3-year graduation courses, I think a 5-year integrated course, just by dearth of the amount of 2 extra years that you end up spending in college and learning, gives you something a little more solid to fall back on in life, you know. The need to top it up with, say, a master's or with an add-on qualification is less profound in a 5-year integrated course than it is after you, say, pursue a 3-year graduation in any field. So that was one sort of major reason for choosing the law. The host of other reasons I have already discussed in my presentation. How I made that happen, yes, I burned the midnight oil quite literally after the 12 board exams were over, because I wouldn't be lying when I said I did not know. I knew that my board exams went well, but, you know, nobody walks out of the school auditorium thinking that you'll do superbly well, or that, you know, if after having written a good exam, you don't end up walking out of the auditorium feeling, oh, I must have just trashed it. So you're sort of operating on in an area of confidence at a level of optimism, but, you know, you don't know whether you'll be able to score as much as it takes to sort of meet a DU cutoff. Engineering was out of the mind. So law was, I had to give it my all. And I think that level of pressure is important for a student to work hard. And I think with Career Launcher's right guidance, it worked in my favor. I would also like to tell the students here who are perhaps considering engineering. See, we have around 15 lakh engineers who graduate in India currently every year annually, vis-a-vis around 80 to 90,000 lawyers. BCI is not very regular in, you know, updating those figures. So 18 times, you know, that's the difference. So even if you were to think, sort of take a step back and think logically about it, about your job prospects, no matter what you want to do after you've pursued the law, how can a market accommodate all 15 lakh engineers? And isn't it easier for a market to, you know, sort of diversify it, look at other people with varying skill sets too, and wouldn't your chances as a lawyer to fill your tummy and your family's tummy, if livelihood is the concern, or if you have other more, you know, developed concerns on Maslow's hierarchy, wouldn't that be achieved easier for you if you were in an area wherein you have less number of graduates coming out into the market every year? So, of course, the decision is yours, but you should ask yourself a lot of questions before making this decision.
Okay. So another question which, you know, people wanted to ask me on their behalf is, what are Bhuvanya's goal now, professional goal? Where do you see yourself 15 years down the line?
Okay.
Doing what? Yeah.
So I'd given a brief, actually, profile to Mr. Mittal. I'm glad you're letting me talk about myself now. Yeah. After I graduated in 2018, for a brief 4-month period, I worked as a LAMP fellow. LAMP stands for Legislative Assistance to a Member of Parliament. This is done by an organization called PRS, and it really helps, you know, in the public policy law intersection. I was lucky enough to be assigned to a star MP, Mr. Jyotiraditya Scindia, and I worked in his office for around 4 months. Ever since, I have switched to academia and research in international environmental law with a special focus on international climate change law. So I'm assisting Dr. Lavanya Rajamani, who happens to be the first Rhodes Scholar from my college, and she's currently a professor at the University of Oxford. So I assist her in, you know, her research publication and sometimes also in her other research work. So as of now, that is the way forward. I intend to apply for a master's very soon, corona situation permitting. And yes, Mr. Manoj had asked me the question at the beginning of the session about my inkling for a career in the public services. I wouldn't rule that out. And, you know, maybe if I'm able to devote myself 100% to it, it should work out. So those are my plans for now. I also had one student here asking me, ma'am, are you working in a corporate sector? No, to answer your question. I did not even sit for my campus college recruitments, which happened at the end of the fourth year. And yes, there are students, you know, the top 5 students from NLS end up getting packages as much as also 25 to 26 lakhs per annum. And it is, of course, never an easy decision to, you know, stay away from the lure of money. But I consider myself blessed. It always came very easy to me. I was never pursued the law for the money. It was more for the academic gratification.
Okay, great. So thank you. So coming back to Utsav. Hello, Utsav. Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
So Utsav, how to crack IPM? How do you go about it? What exactly you did?
So all year for preparing for IPM, I did not. I remember that Bhuvanya was the one who I talked to about the IPM course, because even she had cracked the aptitude test.
Yeah, I remember. Yes,
in the middle of the year, I just reached out to Bhuvanya and I said that I was thinking I'll also give this examination. And do you know how I should crack it, how I should go about it? And I think I started my preparation after talking to her and after my board examinations. That was when I first, you know, bought a book and, you know, started doing some practice and self-study for this. But the larger advice that I want to give to people preparing for IPM is that it is a very, very, very competitive course now. When I gave the examination, there were 10,000 people who had applied. I'm sure, you know, the figure has tripled or, you know, increased 4 times now. So not just do you need self-study, you need a structured method of self-study. You need, you need an environment where you are able to see how your peers are studying. You need an environment where you are able to see where an instructor is able to guide you. Okay, that this is, you know, the subject or this is the topic that you're lacking in, and this is what you need to prepare for. So while in my year, it was perfectly fine to do self-study. It was perfectly fine to, you know, just buy a practice book and, you know, begin practicing through that. I would really advise people to, you know, join a proper program, you know, put in those hours, you know, study with your peers, join Career Launcher and, you know, go for a structured program where they offer you, okay, this is the topic, this is the fundamentals of the topic, and this is how you need to practice for it. This is regarding the IPM aptitude test. When I was applying, there was no personal interview. There was only a personal interview. There was no written analysis test. So for my personal interview, I reached out to Mr. Manoj Mittal. And, you know, I had some very rigorous, you know, mock interviews at Career Launcher. And those are the ones that prepared me to crack the personal interview. And I think that the personal interview is the toughest stage of cracking IPM, because a lot of colleges have, you know, aptitude tests, a lot of courses test your mathematics, your English ability and things like that. But at a class 12 level, to sit for a personal interview, that is very rare. So to be able to figure out what is the correct interview etiquette, to be able to figure out what is the correct, you know, way to guide a conversation in an interview, to answer questions in an interview, those are some things which are very rare for the students to prepare for. So I do advise people to join a professional program, prepare very well, have mock interviews, and that is the way to go to prepare for IPM.
So Utsav, there is one more question on the chat box. So one student is asking, what is better? IPM is better, or, you know, going through CAT, GMAT, you know, Aditya Chaudhary is asking this question.
Right. So, let me examine better from my perspective about better. If you're someone who likes to study about different subjects, who wants to be someone who is more intellectual, who wants to be someone who has a better grasp and a wider, understanding of different topics, then IPM is definitely a better program. One of the biggest advantages of the IPM program is that you do not have to crack CAT, you know, at a later stage. You are in your class 12 right now, you have a very, very good mathematical ability, you have a very good language ability. So now is the time when you are in a perfect mood to study, when you are in mood to crack examinations. You never know 4 or 5 years down the line whether you are in the same frame of mind, whether you'll have the same time to, you know, sit down for a tough exam like CAT and, you know, crack that again. So therefore, instead of taking the risk of, you know, waiting 4 or 5 years down the line, cracking the CAT after doing some generic engineering course or doing a, you know, some other undergraduate course, it is better that you join a professional program now, because not only does that give you better career prospects, not only does that, you know, save you the advantage of, not having to give the examination later on, but it also builds, you know, you into a better person. It builds you into a more engaged person who knows about more subjects, who has a better, deeper understanding about management. And recruiters see that, and that is rewarded when you sit down for, you know, campus recruitments and things like that.
So there is one more question, right, from Ayushi. And she writes that, I am pretty sure that I don't want to pursue engineering and medical as a career, but most of the people suggested me to take PCM, as science students can easily crack competitive exams rather than commerce students. So I'm confused. Please help me with this, sir.
So I really think it's a very big myth to think that science students can crack examinations and commerce students cannot. You know, that is a very demeaning thing to say. And I think that's very wrong. So whether you're a science student or whether you're a commerce student, take up something which you like to study. If you are aiming for a career in management later on, I do advise you take, you know, the commerce stream, understand economics, you'll have a better foundation to work on. But, whether you take science or whether you take commerce, take it on the basis of what subjects you like to study. If you have no passion to study engineering or medicine later on, you do not need to take science, take up commerce. Not only will that still keep a lot of doors open for you, that will not give you a disadvantage in competitive examinations, and you will gain a good foundation in, you know, management subjects that you will study later on.
Absolutely. So we'll take the last question. So Sonal says, there is one more question from Aditi. We'll take both. So is it better to go for jobs after graduation for work experience or go for an MBA? That's one. So what's your opinion, Utsav?
So Sonal, I'm assuming that you're talking about, not the IPM course, some other course, and then whether you should go for work experience or you should go for MBA. I think both are equally valid. There are some companies who desire people who are older and who have work experience, but today most companies are young, internet companies like Amazon, Make My Trip, Flipkart, all of these companies value people who are freshers, who are not burdened by the way of thinking of some other company and who can mold and train into, whatever they want them to. So whether you join, an IIM or a B school with work experience or without work experience, I don't think it'll make any difference. If you're able to clear CAT, well and good, join without work experience, that should be good too.
Okay. So we'll take the last question. Aditi is asking, how's life at IIM Indore? Is it difficult, stressful?
So life at IIM Indore is very hectic, and I think it will be you know, any course which is worth its weight in salt will be difficult and will be stressful. You are in an environment where you have to give exams every 3 months, you have quizzes every week, you have 4 or 5 classes, after that you have extracurricular activities. But the point is that even though it is very hectic, every moment of it is enjoyable. I remember that, you know, when I was in college, I was running around all day. I had no time to sleep, but I would still go back to it anytime, you know, any chance I get, because even though it's very hectic, that every moment is enjoyable. You're learning something new all the time. And generally about life at IIM Indore, there is a huge campus in Indore. It is on the outskirts of the city. There are a lot of facilities available and it's a very enjoyable and very great life.
So I'd just like to interrupt, take a minute. I have some 4 private questions lined up. So if I could just devote a minute each, do we have the time permitting?
Yes, of course.
Yeah. So the first question is, of course, on the lines of how both these exams are aptitude tests. Yeah, you're right. Of course, Utsav can speak better for the IT math. I can talk about the CLAT. But yes, I believe at the end of the day, having written the IT math too, including the interview stage, both of these exams, yes, are aptitude tests. So please make sure that more than focusing on, you know, how to complete current affairs of the last 1 year in time, or, you know, how to focus on the static GK and CLAT, or how to remember the most legal maxims for the legal knowledge portion of, say, ILET, maybe CLAT doesn't have asked those kind of questions anymore. Focus on time management. Focus on writing as many mocks as possible so that you understand how quickly are you able to answer a question in that limited amount of time. I think if Mr. Mittal can guide me, CLAT still has the same pattern of 2 hours and 150 questions. Am I correct, sir? So either way, the thing is that time crunch is a major issue. So you shouldn't fret so much about, you know, how much I need to study and how many hours of study I need to put in for, say, CLAT prep at least, as much as you need to focus on how will you be and what state of mind you will be in when you're writing that exam there, taking that exam in the exam hall. So please try to give as many mocks as possible and, you know, sort of pick up on your speed, especially your reading speed, because a bunch of those questions give you a paragraph before you can read the question and, you know, sort of answer which multiple choice answer is correct. So reading speed is exceptionally important. Try to, for those of you who are not in a regular habit of reading the newspaper, at least try to go through the editorial segments of the, you know, the newspaper. So pick up whatever leading daily, if you want a business paper, Hindu Business Line or the Live Mint or something, and for any other national daily, Indian Express, whatever suits you, and pick up, just read the editorials perhaps. And, you know, just measure your speed and how you are able to grasp the core concept in a comprehension passage, treat them as a comprehension passage and how quick you're able to read that passage over time. So I think that would help. The second question was asked by Mr. Adi Jain. He said, what have you thought about litigation? So Adi, I'm an advocate. I am registered and I'm enrolled to practice under the Karnataka State Bar Council. So about litigation, I would tell you, if you pursue a 5-year degree or even a 3-year degree in the law, litigation is the core. You know, the careers and prospects after law beyond litigation are the buffer, but litigation is the core. And whatever, you know, illustrious names that I posted on a slide, the slide which was titled After the Law, all of these people were litigators at the beginning of their career. They were all practitioners in the law. And in many ways, it is the most exciting prospect after studying the law, because, you know, it gives you this face-to-face exposure, daily brush with the law. At multiple moments in a day, you are having a brush with the law, be it the courtroom dynamics, be it the engagement with the client, or be it just the satisfaction of having helped the client. The litigation for me, in my personal opinion, is the absolute best, you know. Okay, I'll move to the next question. Hello, ma'am. I just want your advice how to cope with 12 studies and class studies. Attending online classes makes me mentally so tired and then I have to stay up all night to study. So please, can you guide me how to manage time? So that's a very pertinent question. Time management is important. Please understand that when you wake up in the morning, you have a limited quota of energy for every day. And the choice is yours where you wish to expend that energy. So you need to sit down and figure out that within my bodily constraints, what's the best way for me to optimize? whatever is sapping that energy, whatever is taking away from the most productive time of your day needs to go. It's as simple as that. I don't wish to sound like, you know, a teacher or a parent who says, please stay clear from distractions. I think certain distractions can have a recreational purpose, but the control should be in your hands. You know, so if you are spending more than, say, you're spending an inordinate amount of time on social media or on Netflix or, you know, whatever the new age distractions are, or if a certain, you know, relationship, interpersonal relationship is taking up more time than you can expend, you are the best judge. All of you are young adults now. I'm believing I'm talking to a mostly class 12 student. So at the end of the day, you need to optimize your energy. You don't need to manage your time. You need to manage your energy. So if waking up in the morning and studying works best for you, please do that. If staying up late at night and burning the midnight oil works for you, do that. But make sure that even if you spend just 4 hours a day studying, you are doing just that. And it is, you know, your brain is working at 100% retention and absorption capacity. So that is how you need to manage. Please be careful about your screen time too. I can understand that the pandemic has left us, you know, at a place wherein we have all become even more digitally dependent. That's both a good and a bad thing. So make sure that on a daily basis, you have only a limited number of classes which you're attending online, and the rest can be supplemented by your hard text book. You know, that's good for your eyes, and I can understand the mental stress of, you know, having to attend all these lectures online too. So that would be my advice. If there are certain other issues, please feel free to seek out help, professional help too. Success ratio for selection in NLUs is comparatively low. My parents suggest for a backup. What is your take about it? So you're right. CLAT right now gives admission to around, I think, 22 national law universities. Of course, there are a bunch of around 40 other universities in the country which accept your CLAT score. But NLUs are only, I think, 22, if I'm correct. And on an annual basis, you have around, I told you earlier that you have around 80,000 to 90,000 lawyers in this country, you know, turned out of these colleges on an annual basis. But all of those from NLUs are only 2,000. So, you know, that's a very minuscule number. If you talk about the top, I talk about my college, National Law School, Bangalore, only 80 students get admission every year. Of course, there'll be some changes, you know, I think next year onwards because of a certain Karnataka quota that has been included now. But as things stood till now, we had 50 general category seats and 30 category reserve seats. So the competition is naturally very, very tough. It is understandable for you to prepare a plan B. And depending on how you anticipate scoring in your boards, your plan B can be, you know, your 3-year graduation courses. If you have appeared for, a bunch of students also appear for engineering entrances, you know, engineering entrances are the top priority, CLAT is the second priority. So whatever it is, I mean, I do appear for the IP math program, you know, and for a good part, I was more convinced to take up IP math than even CLAT. So it's relative, make the best decision as of the moment, but yes, it's important to have a plan B. Don't put all your eggs in one basket, please. What have you thought about litigation has been done? I'm preparing for CLAT, but I feel like it is hard to pursue law as a career without a family background in it. Is it so? The most delightful aspect of stepping onto a path which has not been explored by your family before is that it is all so new to you. You know, you are approaching it with a fresh perspective and unbiased mind. Professionally speaking, I can't help but agree that yes, you have certain very limited and tight legal families in this country who, you know, sort of at least make up for a good part of your judiciary and also in terms of well-performing advocates. But that by itself is a very, very minor reason. It should not be a major reason, significant enough to deter you from pursuing the law and having a successful career at it. In fact, you should take it as something that, you know, you have entered a field with no baggage. And that's something, you know, which people die for otherwise. So take it in your stride and be positive about it. And the final question was about taking up science and then pursuing the law. I did not want to, my utmost loyalty was to St. Joseph's Academy after class 10 too. Of course, I wanted to pursue humanities, but SJ at that time wasn't offering humanities. And I was very clear in my mind. I mean, whatever I have to do to stay in the school, I would do. Of course, I've been a good student, so I did not, it was not too much of a struggle for me to, you know, take up science as against humanities. Commerce was something where, you know, just the nature of the subject, some of them I was not personally very interested in. I found them a bit dry. So I felt I could work out a better board percentage too with science subjects. Whether science, reading science till class 12 helps in class or not, perhaps not in class directly, but in terms of, you know, the scientific aptitude that you develop, yes, it might. To tell you about my batchmates, I had 80 batchmates in the batch of 2018 in NLS Bangalore, out of which 66% were science students. 66 did science till class 12. Of course, there are several reasons behind these percentages. You know, most of them may have been, you know, sort of convinced by their parents or by the teachers to just take up science because it keeps their options open, et cetera, et cetera. But a bunch of them too, and it's, you know, it's not difficult to interact with all 80, it's a small batch. And in my personal conversations with them, I've realized that almost all of them were very convinced about their decision to, you know, take the science. And in many ways, it perhaps even helped us in our preparatory courses in college. Of course, there were students who had a background in economics. And when we were exposed to economics in NLS, it was initially very tough for us. But we had a better grasp at, say, understanding the graph, understanding the, you know, payoff matrices. So I think it's a balance, it's a trade-off. There's obviously an opportunity cost. You're pursuing science now or later, and you're pursuing humanities now or later. But optimize, make the best of your decision, keeping in mind your interests, the faculty, the kind of students, the peers that you will have taking those courses. Peers really matter at your age. And finally, your ultimate career path in mind. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So I think that, you know, we come towards the close of, you know, the session, conversation with Josephites. So Career Launcher would really want to thank both the superstars. Right. So I, on behalf of entire Career Launcher family, all India Career Launcher family, would want to thank number one, St. Joseph's Academy, first of all, you know, for giving us two superstars. Right. And, you know, so your parents, your teachers, all of them. Right. So I think they've all made a significant difference. So thank you, both of you. Right. And also, I would like to thank Alumni Association, St. Joseph's Alumni Association as well. So for coming on board for this event. And so we are grateful, right? So
thank you so much, sir. Thanks to Career Launcher too for, you know, hosting us and having this session in a very well moderated, balanced way.
Anytime. And thanks once again, right? So from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thanks, Dan. Bye-bye.